1998, Nobel Prize is awarded to von Klinsing and Laughlin and Stolmer and Tracy. Okay, so this quantum Hall state and fractional quantum Hall state is the case that if you apply strong magnetic field on the sample, you will find out the complex plateau of this if you measure the whole conductance, the whole resistivity. And this precision is really precise in the sense you can even test the fundamental constant. Okay, so this is really profound physics. The really low energy, this really precise condensed matter property can test the fundamental constant. And somehow they have phase transition, but without symmetry breaking. In a symmetry breaking sense, means there's no way you can write out Landau Ginzburg like a symmetry breaking potential and make some kind of order parameter to distinguish the phase. For example, like a ferromagnetic phase, so usually this random phase can be defined if you measure this this magnetization, they can define an order parameter. But there's also no crystal order, no spin order, no any kind of charge order. So there must be a new order, it's called topological order. So this is like a new kind of concept to understand what kind of a phase transition really happened in this sample. And this is a general idea as a way to think about this, the framework to think about this. And let me go back to how this really related to what I say about bizarre property between the current. If I really calculate, just put a sample as you know on the annulus, okay? If I put a sample on annulus, and you can do this on experiment. So topologically, you can basically make this into the front and make the outer side circle into the back. So this will become a cylinder. So that's the same topology. And that's what I'm going to talk about. So you can appreciate this. If you put a quantum Hall state on this annulus, you'll find out there's an edge state moving direction oppositely. So say if there's a one, say chiral direction plus modes, there's the anti-chiral modes on the other boundary. Similarly, if I put this on cylinder, I'll have one moving mode here and one moving mode opposite direction. So let's just consider the current, how the current flow on the boundary. It turns out that the description of all the quantum Hall states, they will tell you that the boundary current will flow related to how this external electric field is applied. And that electric field basically will has a relation that you learn from high school, say like the current flow along this y direction through the bulk JY is exactly equal to the whole conductance sigma xy and then the electric field along the x direction. Say this is the way you apply the electric field. But the electric field can be induced if you just, what you learn about Faraday effects. If you have a total magnetic flux change, then what does that happen? You will have an induced E field wind around this loop. So that will be the E field, as I say, wind around the sample. So that's the same thing about this salt experiment in Laughlin. What he did is that you have a magnetic flux goes to the cylinder exactly picture as magnetic flux goes to the annulus, then there will be induced E field by the relation that if I be dt is equal to the loop integral about EBL. So that's what happened, that electric field will wind around. And the sample about quantum Hall states will drag the current from one edge to the other edge. So this is what you can appreciate about this J is equal to sigma E. But the thing is, now just looking into the current on the bulk side, looking into on the boundary side, you will find out the edge current flow, the derivative, the divergence of the edge current flow exactly equal to how this external E field is applied. And the total current actually is conserved in the same edge current need to flow to the bulk. So this current missing on the boundary, this little b is a boundary, this partial derivative on little j is equal to the jy bulk current. So total current conserved in the total system. It's not surprising. But the thing is, if you imagine we living just on 1 plus 1b here, what would you see? You will see the edge current on, say, the left edge will related to the current going through the bulk, jy. Similarly, if you look into the right edge, the current will basically absorb the one going through the bulk. Okay? So any question? I think this will be an easy part that everyone can appreciate. So any question, if you don't understand anything, please interrupt me. I hope at least you can take this. Please. Yes. Yes, 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 yes. So that's exactly what I want to say, is that actually what happened is the current going from this one edge, if you have no electric field induced on this loop, on this winding, which means if I don't insert the magnetic flux, then my edge current will just wind here, and there's a corresponding edge current go the other way. So nothing happened. They just wind in the way like, you know, like it's a good exercise to do this, basically. Okay, there's a picture. Can you get it? Now is that if you insert many flux, what does that happen? So originally you have this, but now this will become this connect here and then go here. So that's the picture. You should get this, I think. Once again, with no magnetic flux, that's a current. If you insert a magnetic flux going through, induce E field along the cylinder, like what I draw, induce the E field wind around cylinder because DTD5B will induce this EDL. The electric field will drink the bulk current, and then the edge current will go through the bulk and then go to the other side. Okay, do you get better? Do you understand this? No? So which means that the edge current on one side will connect to the other side through the bulk. That's all. Everything is conserved. Just like two countries are competing with their economies and there's something connect together. So if one country is losing money, the other is gaining money. Maybe something like this, if you can understand this. So it's some total conservation. Just like you put a pocket, you have a pocket on right, you have a money on right pocket, you have a money on left pocket, and you use your hand to put money from one to the other. That's all. So that's a simple physics. Okay, is that okay? So that's just what happens, just moving one from the other. But this is profound in the sense, if I combine the left current and right current together, I'll find out the vector current is conserved. JL plus JR moving, this will cancel out. So vector current conserved. If I define another current, JL minus JR, that's so-called the actual current. It's a kind of current related to how to test the parity. It turns out this current will not conserve. So that's the physics. It's exactly related to a complicated calculation about one loop. About particle physics. But, so can you see this? You can explain to your field theory friend about how this complicated loop calculation easily calculate from high school physics I just explained. It's really profound, I think. And that's a main kind of idea about how the quantum anomaly, which means this actual current, the JL, left current minus right current, is not conserved, is related to the quantum physics. Okay, so any question? So this is the idea that when you compute this kind of a complicated diagram, or maybe it's not really complicated, it's related to the quantum physics. If there is no contribution about this loop diagram, exactly means that there is no bulk current cannot going through this cylinder. So which means that the edge state current cannot flow from one to the other side. And there's no mathematical detail how this this calculation about this vector, about this loop diagram is exactly related to the whole conductance. Okay, but this is really profound physics. Please.
Okay, I'm just trying to understand the quantum anomaly.
Yes.
Which comes from the quantum fluctuation, right?
Yes.
But this bulk edge correspondence, so
yes,
you just link them by the equation point of view.
Yes.
So nothing with the...
Yeah, it's a good question. Yeah, so in a sense, if you calculate this, actually, it's really related to like a quantum phenomena. You need to even do one loop diagram. But for this, you don't. So why is that? Actually, I'm not 100% sure, but actually, I can only say that the way I use the theory in the book, actually, in terms of the field theory will become some kind of transient theory. So that's possibly the a way to see, but it's not exactly obvious why. But I think it's a good question to think about this. But sometimes you know that if you compute something about a quantum system, actually, you can use more or less like classical path integral to do this. I don't know whether there is some kind of a relation between that. So it's a good question. I don't have a really good answer about that. Okay, so this part I will use a very simple language. I don't want to make everyone not happy. So I always try to talk about latest non-productive definition about anomaly-free theory. Anomaly-free means just there's no, there basically just means that there's two ways to think about this. The anomaly-free just means there's no this loop contribution, or there's no bulk currents going through. There's no current going through the bulk. That's just two ways to think about there's no anomaly. If there's no bulk current going through the, there's no current going through the bulk, then just means this H current will conserve, so there's no anomaly. Anomaly just means something is not conserved, something is disappearing. Okay, just means that if you put current on the edge, you will decay. That means the anomaly, and that won't happen if anomaly is free. Means no anomaly. Just means this one loop diagram does not contribute anything. This will be zero, and also means there's no Hall conductance. There's no current going through the bulk. So let's use some simple language. Let's just draw some picture. So let me just try to think about what's the theory I want to consider. It's like a chiral theory. What I really want to do is I want to define this kind of theory with some moving modes on the edge. And I want to use an idea how to make this edge. Suppose I put this on a stripe or on the cylinder. There are edge modes moving on left and edge modes moving on right. And the idea is that if I have a total system together, I have a correspondent edge space, so it's non-chiral. But if I try to using some kind of like a ferromagnetic or this external magnetic field or some kind of gate, the thing that you do in experiment, try to gap out the system, means that open the mass gap, means that kill the edge space, then I can make the theory only live on this side. And that theory can be a chiral theory. So that's a strategy. So thinking about like there's a highway with a car moving on one direction here, moving the opposite direction here, totally is non-chiral. But if I try to using some kind of technology, as you did in the experiment, try to kill the edge space on one side, then I have a chiral theory on the other side. So that's a strategy. But this will solve the problem in the latest QCD that they try to spend a lot of money and time to do this, but not really significant progress. So the analogy is that, as I say, if you have a highway, there's a one-way chiral modes, for example. If you have multiple ways, you can have many modes, maybe chiral, maybe non-chiral. So that's a picture. And those are just like an edge space of some topological insulator or LPT. But now the thing is, I want a gaping term. Means just the way that you put the external field to kill the edge space. This so-called gaping term, like a ferromagnetic those property. And let's try to use some kind of a wild thoughts. What kind of things you can try to make the traffic stop? So look at this. There's a car moving in one direction, but somehow there's a car accidentally moving in the opposite direction. I don't know how that happened, but this picture captured that. Basically, there's a car moving in opposite direction. So suppose I have a chiral mode moving here. I let one little car just run in opposite direction. Do you think I can make the whole flow stop? What do you think? Yes or no? Yes or no? Just give me an answer. Do you think you can stop the car? Stop the flow of the car just by putting one car moving in opposite direction? Yes or no? Just some answer.
No,
right? Yeah, no. I think it's too naive. But there's some way, for example, you shouldn't count that if the amount of things that you did is tiny, then you cannot really make the traffic stop. Maybe there's some kind of strange case that you can think about like an impurity that you can make the traffic stop. I don't know if you understand this or no. No? And there's a way that you can break the rules. Basically, it's possible that you can make a traffic stop. So there are some kind of case that you can make a traffic stop. But the real thing is that the traffic about this, how to stop the traffic is like you need to really have an equal number of lanes collide together. And you also need to make an overall traffic stop, then it's like a momentum conservation. So it's an analogy. But the idea in quantum system is like you need to have a left and right moving more equal number. You also need to have a quantum fluctuation, so-called a Aharon or bone phase, need to be zero. So there's no quantum fluctuation. And the traffic accident is just like a gaping term to aid in the system. And if I have an equal number of left right moving node, then where is chirality? Then the chirality is not from the number of modes in equal number of modes. It's actually come from how the charge is carried and how the charge is violated parity. Okay, so just like the amount of a charge, like the amount of passenger sitting inside the car is not equal left and right. It's just like the parity is broken in for the charge. So that's how we make parity. Okay, so I'll just quickly just thinking about what's really going on. So it's not that easy, but the idea is that, as I say, you have an equal number of left and right moving modes will require this Arnold Bohm phase, this AB phase equal to zero. So this is a condition for the so-called how to make the boundary has no edge space flowing. It's a boundary fully gapping rules. Okay, so this is just the a kind of concept. Take a concept, don't take the mathematics. And another invention just means you compute some loop diagram. It turns out this will relate, as I say, it's relative to whole conductance. This whole conductance will be zero, so that formula will relate to this. Like a charge Q and K inverse Q will be zero. The K is just the coupling constant of the transient theory. So the math actually becomes simple. The relation between the two means, this anomaly means there's no contribution about loop diagram. This Q, K inverse Q, zero is exactly equal to so-called Arnold Bohm phase. It's trivial. The phase is zero, or exponential is one. So these two conditions are equivalent. And how do you know this is equivalent? Of course, I need to prove. So we have a proof in the paper. But this is profound in the sense we relate this quantum phenomena in so-called particle physics related to so-called topological insulator. And these two concepts are actually really related. And I'll give a simple example. If I just have one chiral mode moving, then I can describe the low energy theory. But it turns out this theory, if you insert a flux, just like you put this flux through the annulus, then the current will flow. And that means that, as I say, that the current flow through the bulk means the theory is anomalous. There is something on the edge current not conserved. The edge current not conserved means anomalous, symmetry breaking, strange things. The boundary means boundary cannot be gapped by the theory we just proved. And that's means that we cannot, even for our approach, cannot put this model on the lattice consistent with this Lagrangian. And this is actually consistent with this theory, so-called fermion doubling problem. Okay, it's just called NN theory, Nielsen-Neo-Nielsen. But the thing can be better if I have two modes. So if I have two modes, carry charge opposite 1 and minus 1, then the left moving charge is 1, right moving charge is minus 1. Then I can make the total anomalous current become zero. So I still can have a non-trivial charge assignment, but I actually make no current flow through the bulk. There's no anomalous current. Anomaly is free. And by the theorem we prove, actually means the boundary can be gapped. You can, if you use experimental device, try to gap the system, there's a way you can really gap, make a mass gap, or just try to kill the edge states. So this should be a model we can simulate. So I'll just say, in this low energy theory, we have a way to describe a Hamiltonian to describe this system. So this is very quickly. If we try to write down that theory, this is a fermion theory. And the good way to think about this theory from a transient theory in a bulk is actually a so-called a boson theory on the boundary, as I write in the very beginning. So what we really do is actually bosonize and fermionize this theory. It's in 1D you can do this. What you find is actually there's an extra term you can add. It's called Psi-Golden term. Maybe some of you heard of this. You can add this term to make the edge state stop. This term, just like a white source that I try to illuminate, just add some strange term. Try to make the edge space on one side. See the shadow here. Those shadow here means I impose some like a ferromagnetic or whatever device to make the system kill the edge states, but without break symmetry. So this is different from ferromagnetic or other kind of gate, this kind of device. But the idea is these two are actually related. I can just say, okay, I add this term and then I can get a boundary and make the theory anomaly free. So this procedure will be complicated, but let me just illuminate that this original theory is bosonized to this theory. And this theory obeys the symmetry, but can gap out, which means open the mass gap of the edge space. So there are two terms. One is on the edge A and edge B. There's a term on the x on edge B. So what we have is that this theory will have to go back to the original fermion theory as this. What we really need to do is maybe something that you have learned. Essentially, a Hamiltonian we can write down. The low energy describe this, but this Hamiltonian is write down on the latest scale, so it can do non-perturbatively. You can run it from a low energy IR infrared limit to the UV ultraviolet really length scale like the latest constant. So this is a non-perturbative way to do this theory. So that's a proposal. It looks very simple because you know this first term is just hopping term on the latest. The second term is next nearest neighbor hopping. And I just add a gapping term. It's like a usual like a coupling between the fermion. So why is that spatial? It seems like you can even do it, right? So that's true. You can do it because if you put this Hamiltonian on this cylinder and put the lattice on, then you can simulate. There's a kinetic power, as I say, hopping term. There's a mass gap, the one that you have an external input. Then the thing is that you might have heard about the thing about Chern insulator. The Chern insulator is just a way to simulate the quantum Hall space on the lattice instead of a continuum. And the way to do this is just have a non-trivial pi flux, just like there's a magnetic flux going through this lattice, but not from the external input. It's due to the complex coupling constant. If I have a coupling, complex coupling constant on here, then I put the lattice in real space. This is real space. This is lattice constant. Then I actually can simulate edge space moving on to edge, okay? And I can just put a ladder, which is just like a sideways difference. I can simulate this. Okay. So this is the result. It's simple enough that you can run it on a tabletop. And this will be the case if you put on the K-space Brillouin zone, then this will be like a flat band, maybe some of you know. And if you put this on torus, this will be a Brillouin zone will have a flat band, just like a Landau label, the thing that you have an electron moving on the external magnetic field, there's a zero lambda level, first lambda level, it's almost flat. But if you put on cylinder with two edge cards, just like what I drew over here, then you have edge modes moving, connect to bulk. This is like the bulk gap. On the top, on the bottom, this is energy level. And this connects the bulk and, to gap in the bulk is actually the edge space running. So this is energy level, how they connected. And the point is that this is regular phenomenon, so-called Chern number is non-zero. And it can achieve by just using this kind of simple Hamiltonian. Any question? So this is also a hot topic in, I think people are driving, try to understand quantum Hall states on the lattice. But I'm just using the free part to understand this. And I'm going to propose the gapping part is just the usual coupling between the fermion. So this is like a usual like BCS, what you learned in, earlier in the morning. You can solve this Bobo-Dejean equation and find out the energy states. And it really find out that the edge state can be gapped if the coupling of this is larger enough. Then you will find out the density on the opposite edge on B will be really tiny, 10 to the minus 5 or something. So I can achieve the model. I can achieve the model by just this simple example. Put on lattice. And this will have a chiral edge mode. That's the goal. I want to define the theory non-perturbative on the cylinder. That's the Hamiltonian. So I achieve my goal. Okay. So certainly I don't have much time. I try to slow the path. The path I talk. So I have a more non-trivial example with four modes, and the result will be more complicated. But the idea is the same. If we try to gauge this theory, it's a chiral theory, this will be a chiral gauge theory, and we propose some general procedure to do this. And so kind of we ask these two key questions, how to relate the anomaly to bulk age and correspondence, and how to define this really non-perturbatively. And this is a long-standing challenge. People in Caltech like Preskill and Norberger and Kaplan in Washington, at all, they all try to attempt to solve this problem, but I think they have some result, but they certainly cannot solve the chiral gauge theory problem yet. But we have a proposal, there is a way we can really really propose a non-productive gauge theory if we have a theory which has no anomaly, means no anomaly emission satisfied, then we can aid the problem to gap out the boundary, the picture I just drew. Then we can divide the theory non-productively. That's the theory we will address. Okay, so let me just skip the chiral gauge theory. And let me just end with what I start with. I just want to give you a kind of a long-term goal is that we are trying to understand this topological order state, and there is a lot of class SPD order. We have no topological insulator. There are Z2 class for 2D and 3D in the free system, quasi-free. And there's also a Houdin spin trend long ago, SO3 symmetry, Z2 class. And we also know fractional quantum Hall states. But those states actually are just a tiny corner of a last of a class which can understand by this kind of a general procedure that I just outlined in the very beginning. It's a short-range entangled SPT, it's a long-range entangled topological. And there is no ground state degeneracy for SPT, doesn't depend on topology, but the topological order depends on topology of the space. Okay. And the punchline in the end turned out that the anomaly, the quantum phenomena really related to the topological phase. People studying particle phases, the anomaly related to the topological phase, and that's proposed by Professor Wen. So the really idea is that if we try to classify those phases, put on a kind of phase diagram, tune the coupling, it turns out that we can roughly say there's a short-range entangled state, SRE, and long-range entangled state, LRE. If we improve even more symmetry, like a Z2 time reversal, then we can make those phases even break to a subclass, subphase. And those languages are nowadays kind of understand even more. So Kitab has those K-theory, and then there's also group cohomology to understand this. And the general idea is the topological phase really related to the anomalous phenomena. Anomalous, just like the H state is flowing, and there is something, current can disappear from the H if you insert the flux. So this is a really concept. So I'm almost done. So we propose this non-productive definition, and then we basically use the idea that we have two H, like this H, and it's a mirror H, and we add interaction to get out the edge, find out the condition, make the edge stay stuck here. So the symmetry is still preserved, that's our method. But the idea turned out this anomaly-free condition means that we need to have no topological order and no symmetry protective order. It means actually the bulk we have is a trivial insulator. That's a more kind of deeper understanding of what we need. What's the theory we really study? And there's a connection to quantum information we are trying to collaborate with people at the Parameter Institute to use a density matrix renormalization group to find out the ground state of the system. And again, just to punctualize, I have these two key questions, the anomaly and the non-perturbative definition. And the answer is the anomaly is related to how to gap out the boundary, and then anomaly-free theory can be defined by putting a strong interaction on the mirror sector, the H states. So this is the end, as almost. I just want to answer the question, the wonder of the universe, and I'm not the right person to answer, but I think in terms of Professor Wen, I think people from Tsinghua might know that there's some idea that actually we condensed matter physicists may just care about like show scale things, but this really can help us to understand the deeper goal of the universe. It turns out that using a bosonic spin system, one already can answer the question how to create identical particle, how to have an emergent gauge interaction, how to induce Fermi statistics, and how to have a chiral gauge theory, as I just mentioned, and how to make the fermion mass very small. But we still have some mystery about Lorentz symmetry and the quantum gravity, like graviton emerged from the lattice is not known. But this is too far reaching, but I think there's something about the things we are studying about long-range entanglement, and they can help us to answer the connection from condensed matter to the wonders of the universe. Thank you very much.
Any questions?
Yes, simple questions, by any question. Or feedback, whatever. Or something is not clear.
Can you talk a little bit about the